Hello and welcome to the next edition of the Briefings Direct Voice of the Innovator podcast series. I'm Dana Gardner, Principal Analyst at InterArbor Solutions, your host and moderator for this ongoing discussion on the latest insights into hybrid IT management. IT operators have, for decades, been playing catch-up to managing their systems amid successive waves of heterogeneity, complexity, and changing deployment models. IT management technologies and methods have evolved right along with the challenge, culminating in the ability to optimize and automate workloads to exacting performance and cost requirements. And that automation is about to get an AI ops boost from new machine learning and artificial intelligence capabilities, just as multi-cloud deployments become more demanding. Stay with us now as we explore the past, present, and future of IT management innovation with a 30-year veteran of managing IT management. And with that, please join me in welcoming Doug Duard. He's Senior Product Manager for Infrastructure Management at Hewlett-Packard Enterprise. Welcome, Doug.
Thanks, Dana. Glad to be here.
Well, you know, management in the enterprise and IT has, for me, been about taking heterogeneity and taming it and bringing it down to a place where people can operate. And that's been a 30-year journey. Heterogeneity, however, Doug, these days includes so much more than it used to. We're not talking about platforms. We're not talking about frameworks. We're talking about hybrid cloud, multi-cloud, SaaS applications, the opportunity to work across organizational boundaries with your partners and integrate processes in ways that never happened before. So with all of that complexity, with the new emphasis on automation, where do you see management, IT management now as compared to, say, 20 years ago? And where should we think about, how should we think about it differently going forward?
Yeah, well, I think, heterogeneity has another term, I think, is chaos. And trying to move from the traditional, the traditional silo, the traditional tools that we have into the more agile, the more, flexible types of things. You have consumers of that. You have producers of that. Your IT management is all about your types of applications like, human resources types, things, finance, run the core of your business. But yet you also are probably doing development and, doing internal things. And the models for those can be very different. And trying to do that in a single manner is difficult because you've got widely varying kind of endpoints there.
It's almost like we're managing the management, right?
Exactly. And so, trying to figure out how do I do that and do that in an efficient and economically feasible way, that's a big challenge.
So I've been watching the IT management space for 20 plus years. And every time you think you've gotten to the point where you've managed everything that needs to be managed, something new comes along. It's a journey. It's a process. But now we're talking about bringing intelligence and we're using automation. Do you think we really will get to the point where management becomes buried, or becomes sort of subsumed in the rest of what people do with IT?
I think to a certain extent you can automate tasks, but you can't automate people, and you can't automate internal politics, and you can't automate budgets and things like that. So I think what you do is you automate, and that provides you that flexibility. But it's not just the technology; it's the economics, it's the people, and by putting all that together, it's a balancing act, trying to make sure that you have the right people in the right places, and also the right organizations. But yet the economics of CapEx, OpEx types of things. So you can automate, but it's all within the context of that bigger, broader picture.
Now, when I think also about management, it seems that you need to have a framework of sorts. And you all have worked with OneView as sort of a core, and then you've built things that integrate with that, and then you manage through that. Where does OneView go from here? How should people think about the technology of management that can help on those political and economic issues?
Well, I think OneView is just an outstanding core infrastructure management, but it's kind of like a car. You can have a great engine, but you still have to have all the other pieces. And so part of what we're trying to do with OneView, and we've been very successful, is extending that capability out into other tools that people use. And so this can be into more traditional tools like Microsoft or VMware partnerships, and exposing and bringing OneView functionality into those more traditional things, but then also in more the DevOps and the continuous integration development types of things with Docker and Chef and Puppet and all those, the whole slew of partners. And we have, at last count, probably at least 30 or more partners that we have. So what that allows you to do is have the, have the confidence that you have OneView driving this as a core engine, but all these other pieces pieces can be customized to do what you need to do, but yet you still have that underlying core foundation of OneView.
And with HPE increasingly going to an as-a-service orientation across many products, how does management as a service work?
It's an interesting question because part of management, depending on exactly how you define management, but you know, if you think in the traditional sense, and you have a data center full of servers, you want to be, and depending on which aspect of management, but if you look at, say, fault management or break fix, hard drive fail or something like that, you want to be close and you want to be in, have that notification immediately. And as you start going up in the cloud with some of that, you have connectivity issues, you have latency issues. So it becomes a little bit trickier when you have more up levels, up the stack, where you've got software that can be more flexible on that and you can do more coordination. Then the cloud makes a lot of sense for that. But so it kind of depends on which angle you're coming from. So management in the cloud can mean a lot of things. If it's the infrastructure, you tend to want to be closer to the infrastructure, but not exclusively. A lot of room for creativity there.
And speaking of creativity, how do you see people innovating both within HPE, but also in your installed base or users? How do people innovate with management now that it's gotten to the point where it's got that services orientation, where you're crossing organizational boundaries, both on and off premises? It seems to me that there's an awful lot you could do with management in terms of beyond red light, green light, and into actual optimization and efficiency and productivity goals. So where's the innovation happening with IT management?
Well, I think there's a couple of things. I think the foundation of it all begins with the automation aspect of it, because if you can automate, you become repeatable, consistent, and reliable, and those are all good things in your data center. And what that does, it's been something we've talked about, if you free up your IT staff to do other things, but the reality of it is that's the truth, is if you can do that reliably, you can spend more time innovating and thinking and looking at your problems from a different angle, because you have more time to do it, and you have that confidence that the automation parts is giving you that. But I think then you can then look at that automation still drives the creativity in a lot of different ways. You can be faster to market, you can have quicker releases, those types of things. So yeah, I think automation is the key there.
And examples, I know sometimes you can't name customers, but can you think of instances where people are innovating with management in ways that would illustrate its potential?
There's a very large biotech genome sequencing company, or group, that is very innovative and is basically changing. They can change their configuration on the fly based on what they want to do, and they can flex their capacity up and down and based on that. And, depending on what task is, how much compute power, how much storage, and they have a very, very flexible way. They have it all automated, all scripted, and they kind of can turn on a dime on a very large, IT organization, and they've had some pretty impressive things in terms of, we need to repurpose. Today we're doing X and tomorrow we're doing Y, or tonight we're doing Y. And they can repurpose that literally in minutes versus, sometimes days and hours for some of those traditional tasks.
And are they innovating in a way that allows them to get the view across the entire life cycle of product, their product in IT? I'm thinking right from requirements through development, deployment, test, redeployment. So is there an opportunity for them to get a view of that entire process rather than doing this innovation in bits and pieces?
Yeah, they string all of these processes together using a lot of different partner tools that, again, at the core, using things like OneView and Synergy underneath the covers to provide that real raw engine. But by using the partner, the HPE partner things that we have with OneView, they do have that visibility, and they get into things like Docker Swarm and things like that, where it may not be the OneView itself providing that total visibility. Certainly at the hardware and infrastructure level it is, but because we're feeding up into upper level, broader applications, they are able to see that, and they're able to see what's going on here, what's happening here, and how do we need to adjust to, meet the needs of what our compute requirements are.
Thinking about what you mentioned in terms of HPE Synergy and composability, what's the relationship between composability and IT management? Are people making a whole greater than the sum of the parts with that?
I think they're trying to. I think there's still a learning curve. There's just traditional IT. I've been around a long time, like you have too, and just the mentality and the skill sets and things, it just takes a while, and internal politics and all those other things, it takes a while to kind of get to that point of saying, yeah, and embrace that this is a good way to go. So I think once they kind of dip their toes in the water and they see the benefits of this, and also how, not just the power of it and the flexibility of it, but in some case the ease of it, they start to see those benefits, and they're like, wow, this is really good. good. And, you know, once you one step, then the next and the next, and pretty soon they're well on their way on the journey.
And we're seeing, of course, more intelligence being brought out of products. So I'm thinking about InfoSight now being in storage and server and other products. It seems to me that's a whole new area of information that you can rise and then use for management purposes. So, you know, we used to have feeds from different products and servers, and then we had agents and agent lists and going across different organizational boundaries for management. But now we've got this intelligence as sort of a feed, if you will, of data and insight. How are you foreseeing what OneView can do with that new level of almost now pervasive intelligence?
Yeah, I think that the InfoSight as a great example. You see this being used in multiple different ways. Things like taking the human part of it out of things like simple things like a customer advisory comes out and says such and such product has a problem and, you know, it affects these products. And you're sitting there looking at 1,000 or 5,000 servers in your data center and you say, I wonder how I'm affected on this. And so you start doing, and you used to have to do a lot of that manually or spreadsheets. And even with the other tools, you're going through and pouring through lists. Now you have the capability to have something spit out and say, these are the ones that are affected. Here's what you should do. And in some cases, should you want us to go fix it right now? So I think that's just an example of how you can do that. But it also makes you more efficient. You start understanding how you're using your resources, where your utilization is, and how you can then optimize that. And depending on how flexible you want to be, you can design your system to respond to those inputs and automatically flex to the places that you want to be. So sort of this autonomous computing, we're probably not there yet, but you know, we're certainly going in that direction where you can respond to different compute, storage, network requirements and adjust on the fly and sort of a self-healing, self-morphing into a continuous optimization kind of a model.
And another big challenge these days is hybrid. So hybrid cloud, hybrid IT, cutting across on-premises, cloud, public cloud, multi-cloud, and then maybe even starting to dynamically move workloads and data across that continuum. People kind of know where they want to go with that, but they don't know how. How does management perhaps help them achieve what they want when it comes to a hybrid environment?
So I think they need to understand what their goals are first. Running a VM in the cloud isn't really where they want to be. And I think that was the initial thing. There are economics of, you know, involved in the cloud, not having to own the infrastructure, CapEx, OpEx, arguments. But just moving your infrastructure from on-premise up into the cloud isn't going to get you where you really need to be. You almost need to look at it from a cloud-native application perspective where you're using microservices and containers and those and cloud-enabled programming languages, your Javas and .NETs and all the other stateless types of things, which then gives you that flexibility to flex performance-wise. But from the management side of that, how you get there is you have to start looking at different ways to do your development and different ways to do your delivery. And that's where the management comes in for doing the DevOps types of things and being able to have the partnerships with those DevOps tools that can help you get there. So you have to kind of flip the way you're thinking to go from the cloud down. And then being able to do cloud application development on-premise, that's one of the great things about containers and cloud-native stateless type applications, is you develop them anywhere. There's no hardware dependencies. So you can develop them on-premises, run them in the cloud, run them on-premise, and then use your hybrid cloud vendors' capabilities to burst up into the cloud if you need it. And that's the joy of having those types of applications. They can run anywhere. They're not dependent on anything, any particular underlying OS. But you have to shift and be able to get into that development. And the automation helps you get there, helps you respond quickly to be able to do that.
And, of course, now that continuum extends to the edge. And there is going to be increasing data analytics, measurement, and even making changes dynamically from that analysis. It seems to me that the way you've designed and architected management is ready-made for that, that the extensibility out to the edge and having to have systems run there, then integrate as needed when appropriate with a core, with a cloud. Tell me how management, as you have architected it over the years, is in a great position to manage the edge.
I think you need to move out your processing further out to the edge in the instant response, instant gratification. I want it now. You can't wait to have an input on the edge and have to go all the way back to a data center, all the way up, and you want to have processing further and further towards the edge so you can get that instantaneous response that customers are coming to expect. But again, being able to automate out how to do that and having the flexibility to respond to differing workloads and, you know, moving that towards the edge, I think is a key to getting there.
And Doug, for you personally, do you have sort of some takeaways from your years of experience about innovation and how to make innovation a part of your daily routine?
Well, I think in, you know, my daily work routine, one of the big impacts that it has had is on our team that I work with is in our QA testing. And it's a very complex thing to test various configurations. That's a lot of work. In the old days, we'd have to manually reconfigure things. And now, as we use a agile development process, testing is a continuous part of it. And you have a variety of features that come in, and you have a variety of configurations. And we've automated all that with our QA part of it, and so that we can respond very, very quickly and keep up with the agile process. And it's really made things a lot easier and a lot less stressful because we can keep up. It used to be testing was always the tail end and the long thing. You did all your development, testing took forever. Now, because we can automate that, it just makes it part of the process, and it's taken a lot of stress off the teams. We're much quicker and more nimble in response, and it keeps people happy too.
When innovation leads to less stress, that's good.
It always is.
As we close out, looking to the future, where do you see management going, particularly how to innovate using management techniques, tools, processes? Where's the next big green light coming from?
Well, you know, I think I'd say what you really want to do is first off get your house in order in terms of take advantage of the automation that you have today and really think about how I can get there and not to use technology as the end. It's just a means to get to where you want to be. And I think you want to define where do we want to be, and where do we want to be has a lot of different aspects. It could be how do you want your culture to evolve? How do you want your customers to what experience do they want to have? And look beyond just, I want this feature or I want that feature, and then design your IT, your development, all of that to get to that goal rather than just saying, oh, I have 100 VMs running on a server. Isn't that great? Well, if it's not achieving the ultimate goal of what you want, it's just a technology feat. And so don't use technology just for technology's sake. Use it to get to the goals and be able to define those goals of how you're going to get there.
All right. I'm afraid we'll have to leave it there. We've been exploring how IT management technologies and methods have evolved, culminating in the ability to optimize and automate workloads to exacting performance and cost requirements. And we've learned that automation is about to get an AI ops boost from new machine learning and artificial intelligence capabilities, just as multi-cloud deployments become more demanding. So please join me in thanking our guest. We've been here with Doug Duard. He's Senior Product Manager for Infrastructure Management at Hewlett-Packard Enterprise. And thanks to our audience as well for joining us for this sponsored Briefings Direct Voice of the Innovator Hybrid IT Management Strategies interview. I'm Dana Gardner, Principal Analyst at Inter Arbor Solutions, your host for this ongoing series of Hewlett-Packard Enterprise-sponsored discussions. Thanks again for listening. Please pass this along to your IT community, and do come back next time.